Hi, welcome back to Love for Mass Solutions. In our previous video, we looked at some differential tubes, most especially the extrema that tells us the minimum and maximum values of functions, and then the ruler's tube. So I promise that in the next video, we're going to look at some examples as far as the application of the ruler's tube is concerned. It's good that you're watching this video because you're just about to look at some examples. So let's look at then we need to remember what the Rolle's theorem says. So here your ability to recall the theorem helps in handling this particular situation. So if you have slightly forgotten, it means you have to go and watch the video concerning the Rolle's theorem and its explanations. But I'll help you a little. Now we're trying to say that let the function be continuous on the closed interval and its first derivative exists in the open interval. So that if f at 0 equals f at a, then there will exist a certain x naught within this interval such that the first derivative will be equal to 0. So let's subject this particular question to the theorem and see whether it's actually satisfactory. So let's see what happens. First of all, this function should be continuous within the interval. So let's have f of x. We have x a squared minus x squared. And the interval we're looking at is a closed interval, 0 and a. That's a closed interval. Now, for us to know whether the function is continuous within the interval, then it's appropriate that we look at possible values in the interval, putting them here and see whether we need to have a continuous interval. Then we want to find out whether its first derivative also is continuous on the open interval. So let's try and differentiate this particular function. So f prime of x, okay, so you're looking at the derivative, be equal to, so how do we differentiate this particular function? So that we have x here. So it's just the product of function. So we are applying the product in the function. So we differentiate. Now we want to find out whether this particular one is continuous on the open interval. So this multiplies this and it gives us this one. Then we have this there. Alright. So we want to find out whether this particular one is continuous on the open interval. So what is an interval? And the interval will be 0, a. Now this interval is open. It means that 0 is not part of the interval and a is not part of the interval. So it's not like the closed interval where we realize that a is part of the interval, 0 is part of the interval and a is part of the interval. But here we are saying that the first derivative should be continuous on the open interval. So if it's the open interval, it means we can put 0 here, we can put a here too, we can put 0 here. That means those things are not part of the interval. So that makes this first derivative continuous on the open interval. So you say that f prime of x is continuous on the open interval. So you have that. It's continuous on that. So if that is the case, then what else do we have to look at? We want to find a function value at 0 and at a. If they are the same, then we will continue from there. So let's find f at 0. F at 0 means that we just put 0 into the any place that we see x, we put 0 there. So we've seen 0, then a squared minus 0 squared, and everything gives us 0. Then let's look at f at a. So it means any place you see s, we're going to write a here. So I see s there, so I write a here. Then a squared minus a squared. So that a squared minus a squared gives us 0. So the square root of 0 is 0, multiplied by this also gives us up to 0. It means that f at 0 is equal to f at a. So gradually the theorem is being satisfied. Then at this point, where we have seen that the function is continuous, its first derivative also continues on the open interval, f at a, f at 0 equals f at a. Then we see that there exists, okay, s naught, which is in the open interval, 0 a, such that f prime at x naught is equal to 0. And so you're saying that then there exists x naught within the open interval such that f at x naught here gives us up to 0. Good. Then if this is in place, alright, so then there exists x naught here, which is within the interval, the open interval 0, a, such that f prime of s naught is defined as 0. So at this point, what we'll do is that we just quickly say that we already have the derivative of the function to be this, okay, this one. So we're going to have f prime of x naught to be equal to, it means whatever we see x within this derivative, we're going to put the x naught. So you have a squared minus x naught squared, and then minus 2x naught squared divided by a squared minus x naught squared. So we can simplify this further. If this is number 1, then we can find the LCM. So that we have here x squared, a squared minus x naught squared. Now this goes here, all of this, so this multiply by that will give us a squared minus so we have a squared minus x naught squared, then minus, so this comes here, and one time. So multiply by the numerator, you're going to have 2 x naught squared.
So you have some good ones. So you definitely best things to have.
Okay, so
having written that, to realize that you're going to have S, A squared, then minus. So then this and this are the same. So we simplify them to become 3, this and that. So we have something like this. But we're saying from here that F prime at S naught should be equal to 0. So it means that we're saying that F prime at S naught should give us a 0. If it's actually going to give us 0, then it means that so this can multiply that. Alright, so cross multiplying, you're going to have A squared minus 3 S naught squared, it gives us 0. We can find the value of x naught. So making x naught your subject, you have x naught to be equal to. We're going to have a squared divided by 3. Alright, so we have that. So that x naught is equal to the square root of a squared divided by 3. X naught gives us, it's going to be a root 3 divided by 5. So that gives us our x naught. Now we can conclude that therefore the function given f of s equals s a squared minus s squared satisfies the Euler's theorem. So Euler's, so satisfies the Euler's. Why is it satisfying the Euler's theorem, you may ask? Because you realize that it's continuous on a closed interval a 0 a. Its first derivative exists in the open interval. The interval, the extremes, f at 0 is equal to f at what, a. And then from there, we say that there exists a certain value within the interval. And the value that we have found here is actually within the open interval 0 and then a. So this